I have known Clive Corbett for nearly 40 years, since he was a history teacher at Heybridge High School in Hagley, and I was a peripatetic music teacher new to the county. I have known many head teachers over the years, and I believe Clive Corbett is exceptional. As he approaches retirement in the summer this year, I was determined to talk with him on camera and capture a few of his often outspoken opinions and views. I asked him first, when did he arrive at Pershore High School?
I started here in January 1996. So just over 21 years ago when I came as deputy head.
And what particular skills brought you here? What did you bring to the job?
Well, it's interesting that, I had never had any great problem getting jobs before. I'd always got things on first interview. So I'd moved from Hagley, I moved to Worcester. But I'd ended up, I think I probably had about three or four deputy head interviews. So by my standards, I was beginning to wonder whether I was actually up to it. But here was the perfect job because my expertise was in the pastoral field. And they basically needed a deputy head teacher to replace Barbara Chidgey, who had gone on to become a head teacher down in South Wales. And her job was very much pastoral. I know they had a year 10 going into year 11 that they were quite concerned about, and they wanted some new ideas for them as well. But I suppose it was bizarre in some ways in that the senior team was quite male dominated. But I came as another man, but I was much more in touch with what had, again, this is an awful, it's a sexist thing to say, what was seen then as the female role within school. So it was about pastoral, it was about citizenship, it was about also ended up being publicising the school and taking forward the school's reputation in the local area too.
Can you describe the school? What were the differences between the school then and the school now?
I think it was much closer then to still being regarded as a secondary modern, because the history of the school was that it had only become comprehensive roughly the same period, 73 to 96, as between 96 and now. And it was still very much viewed by the fact that Prince Henry's was the grammar school, Pershore was the secondary modern. And you'll see that when, without being rude to people, you have gatherings of former students from the 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s. And it was very much a school where the youngsters within it and their families needed to have higher aspirations for themselves, where too many of them were satisfied with low paid, lower level jobs. It was where there was quite a small sixth form. And the school physically was quite different. There were none really of the new buildings that we've had, obviously, in the last 15 years. And that was the case, really, up until round about the turn into the millennium. So, for example, when one looks opposite the caretaker's house, if I point over there, there is what is now the caretaker's store, and unbelievably in a little hut almost, a little caretaker's lodge, was where biology and environmental studies was being taught by Jen Pritchard. Here where we are now was where biology laboratories. There was a horrible fire exit over the front entrance, and there are pictures of that to show. Upstairs in this building where we've now got maths, there were food rooms. There was a bizarre little area called the flat where youngsters spent a day sometimes for independent living. It was all tied in with that. And so across the school, there was a pretty horrible looking modern languages block behind me where the art block now is. Within that, where is now food and textiles technology, there was physics and chemistry. The school was literally all over the place, both physically, in terms of where youngsters went for their lessons. There was a quite different regime. Michael Creer, head teacher, who was here from 1990 to 2002. I'm indebted to him for all the opportunities he gave me. But let's just say that the senior team was not very coherent or cohesive. It was coherent, not cohesive. wrong word. Bob Achigi had gone, as I've said. Tony Pitt was there as deputy head. He actually only stayed until July 96, when he retired early, and therefore very quickly the leadership team was down to me as a deputy and Michael as the head. And then there were other senior teachers like Roger Embry, who was had been head of lower school. He stayed on for probably about 4 or 5 years more. And Graham Booth, who of course is still here into his 41st year, who was senior teacher, responsible for curriculum and timetable and all that kind of thing.
And what about the pupils? How has the numbers of pupils changed?
The number of pupils has changed. I mean, at the moment we're now around about 1,100 pupils, and bear in mind we've also taken a little dip in the last couple of years with two smaller year groups. The future is that we're going to go back up well in excess of 1,200 and even more. The pupil size at that point was probably in the mid-900s. The sixth form was much smaller. I think uniform and general expectations were quite different. Something that Michael was very much fighting against. You know, when I look back even at that first photograph, which was taken in, I think, 2001 or two, just before I took over, you can almost see by the mosaics on the whole school photographs that things look quite different. It was just a little bit, I think uniform was a little shabbier then. Attitudes weren't what I would be happy with now. And it was related, a lot of it, to expectations, reputation, that old secondary modern history, I think.
Mm. And it's a three-tier system around this area, isn't it? So what age do the... that's something you're hoping will change.
Well, it's well known that a couple of years ago that I rattled a few cages in that respect when we went out to consultation. There was a lot of support for it, but the middle schools did understandably mobilise their forces extremely successfully. But this school will, I believe, have year sevens by 2020. There's my prediction on film now. We have first schools that fully intend to take younger pupils so that they will keep pupils all the way through to year six, and things will change. So it's a new reality that everyone will need to come to terms with. At the moment, of course, it's a year 8 to 13 system, an age 12 to 18, but that will change undoubtedly. And with the building over the road, I mean, if you stood at the top of this block and took a photograph looking over Station Road even in November, the field that is currently there to my right and is still a field, that was the way that the field on the left was in November last year. It's now got houses beginning to sprout up. So it's happening at an alarming rate in some ways. It's going to change the area, but it's going to be very good for the continued security of the school.
Do you have a lot of links with the local community?
I think that is another thing that I suppose I have contributed to changing. There were all already community links, but I've worked extremely hard at that. So we've got community links with the town council, and that link is very much through the youth council. That was only introduced probably about 6 years ago. Big links through the Riverside Youth Centre. Links also with Pershore Rotary. We've got an interact club that runs here. Links also with the other schools and other community groups. And, you know, I firmly believe that's extremely important. When I retire, some of the work I'm going to do is with an organisation called Schools of Tomorrow. And the commitment to that organisation is to realise that a school can only do so much in isolation, that in order to improve outcomes generally in the lives of the young people, you have to work with the communities and the families in order to make that difference.
There's been a lot recently about bullying going on in schools. Yep. And I've been told that 73% of staff, not in your school particularly, but 73% of teachers go home worrying about any particular child and their mental attitude or their well-being. Do you take your work home with you as well? And how does bullying affect this school?
Yes, I'll talk about bullying first, and I'll talk about taking my work home. Again, my view and that of the staff is that we want to be completely open about this. We had the tragic case on April the 27th last year when Felix Alexander took his own life. That is something that has led us to be even more determined to work with Lucy, his mum. During the first week of February, she came in and talked to assemblies and launched her Be Kind campaign. That now, as recently as yesterday, the 15th of March, went on to ITV's Good Morning, and we were involved in that. So any school that pretends there is no bullying, the head teacher of that school is a liar. It's as simple as that. Mm. And basically, we want it to be out there that these things happen with young people. And above all, in this day and age, things have changed. It's become more insidious that there is the online, there's the social media from which the youngsters can't escape. So we take that extremely seriously and continue to spread that message of kindness on behalf of Lucy, and are delighted as a result of our little involvement and her massive involvement that the ITV programme, I think, has at last count, even at about 8 o'clock last night, had received 40,000 pledges as a result of the video that went on there and the programme we contributed to yesterday. So as for me, I'll be honest with this place, there's not a lot that I take negatively home with me, but what does help me is that I do have a 30-mile each way journey. That doesn't mean it's because I don't want to be here. It's all kinds of family reasons why we've stayed that distance. But that's very good in terms of kind of tuning in at the start of the day and de-stressing on the way home. I don't do it through road rage, generally. But it does mean that I can give some thought. But the kind of things that do worry me is that obviously things such as bullying do concern me. The financial state of schools in the country, let alone in Worcestershire, do worry me, and sadly that's not going to get any better. But I suppose I've had to engage a bit of a mechanism where I do click off as much as I can. Although in other ways, I'm checking the emails weekends, evenings, all the time. So maybe I'm not quite as good at doing that as I pretend I am.
Switching off is difficult.
It is.
Yes, yes. How has government legislation and finances affected your role as head teacher?
Well, during my period at Pershore, both as deputy and head teacher, which is now 21 years, when I first started here, of course, there was no Ofsted. It soon started up. I think the main issue is that governments of every persuasion have pretended that they allow schools to get on with things, and they don't. There is accountability, and that accountability is to standards and finance. Standards being exam results, finance being keeping in the black. They are the two things that I will not miss about this place when I walk through the door for the last time in August. It'll be a very emotional time, and I'll miss a great deal about the place, the people, the youngsters, and the community, and people such as you being part of that. and as Huey Green used to say, I mean that sincerely. But the point is that the joy is not helped by an organisation like Ofsted that claims to be improving people's lives. What I believe very passionately, and there are organisations across the country on this, is that we're often told that in the PISA tables, I could use a ruder version of the word, that we as a country, along with other countries, are at the bottom of performance. International performance.
Right, thank you.
Well, it's a very good question. What are they? But they are sometimes quite spuriously used to compare educational performance in different nations. And the USA, the UK, we're near the bottom of those tables. But what's interesting is that when you look at tables that look at accountability and government control, we're at the top of that table, and the schools that perform better in standards are at the top of their table. They are at the bottom in terms of accountability and government control. So the lesson to me, the message is simple, is that if governments of all persuasions could trust teachers, trust schools, and where there is an inspection, that doesn't become, let's sack the head, let's make it national, let's make it public, that a support plan is put in place. So I'm not advocating that schools are left alone, because before inspection, some schools were doing ridiculous things and all the rest, but it's just gone far too far the other way. So what I would urge would be some kind of national body that is completely independent of government and political persuasion, that puts, of course, educational performance at the top, but puts the well-being of youngsters, the well-being of staff, that looks at why we cannot in this country recruit and retain teachers. We're at the point where we will put an advert out for a maths teacher. We'll be lucky if even here in lovely Pershore, we get half a dozen people. There are so many schools that have got unqualified maths teachers, unqualified science teachers having to teach, or bits and pieces. So I think the truth needs to come out is that the system's in a mess. And so in terms of government control, that needs to change, because it's not working, and it's not working here, it's not going to work anywhere.
How does your faith come into your work?
Well, I think, although we are not a faith school, it's interesting. We've had this discussion over the Multi-Academy Trust. I'll explain it, and I will answer your question, I promise. Is that we are setting up a Multi-Academy Trust, and it will probably be by around about the 1st of July, with Inkborough First School, Cherry Orchard First School, and Norton Juxta Kemsey. Now, Norton is a C of E school. And so we've been asked by the diocese, which clearly has an input into Norton, and a very important input, you know, are we going to dilute the faith element within that particular first school? Well, we're not, because I think that although we are not C of E, we have standards and a morality, a decency here, where although sadly most of the youngsters in our school would not go anywhere near a church on a regular basis, we've got a Christian union that Claire at the Abbey and the others are involved in. And although that is a small number of children, to me, where my faith comes in, it comes into, well, above all, a fierce kind of almost old Protestant work ethic. I almost said Puritan, but maybe not Puritan, that determined to do my best at all times and to do my best for the children, to make sure that what they experience here, although it is not strictly Christian, that it is about treating other people with respect. And I think that's what makes this place a happy place. It's not a perfect place, because youngsters bully. Staff do not always behave in the way that I want them to behave. But Sandy there shared this a few weeks ago and said, well, it's a message that I give to staff, which I think Sandy had a fantastic point here, that when you speak as a teacher or a member of staff to a young person in this school, reflect on it. Would you speak to them that way if their parent was present? And indeed, the same to a young person. Would you actually speak to an adult? In some cases, they might. When their parent was present, it would be my experience. So the influence of my faith is very much upon those basic values. And I think faith is also linked to community, because what I fear, and I think Pershore is no different, is that going back even to the early years of the 20th century, the church or the chapel was much more the centre of community. Although it should be, it sadly isn't anymore. It is when there's some great tragedy. It's interesting, you know, when we had the Felix tragedy and others, the youngsters needed the likes of the Baptist minister, Claire from the Abbey, to provide that support and counselling. And that's typical human nature, isn't it? We'll say our prayers, we'll sing our hymns when it comes to crises in our lives. But to me, it's this consistent thread that links us to our community, because I think in the absence of people sadly seeing the church that way, the school has to take on part of that role. So I believe very strongly in that. And I think that us joining a MAT with a C of E school is going to be a big, big positive, as well as us being influenced by primary things where we think in secondary we can do it better. Well, we've got lessons to learn and they can learn from us. It'd be fantastic. That's another thing I'll be sadly missing because it won't happen yet a while, but it's a great step forward for the area.
It's now 2017 and you're retiring this summer. Of all your achievements over your 21 years here, what would you like to be remembered as your legacy to the school?
The thing that means most to me, and I've had a few already and I've had many over the years, and I'm not looking for thanks, but the most fantastic things are just little notes from youngsters or little notes from parents just saying, thank you, you've made a difference. Because that is the joy of this job. And I think teachers need to get this, to actually have the opportunity to make a real difference to so many. I mean, if I think about those 20 years, therefore, it must be that I have worked with 2,000 young people, probably about 300-400 staff. And if I've just made a little bit of a positive difference to some of those people, then it's been worthwhile. Because, you know, in the end, I have no intention of dying yet, but, you know, the old, there's no pockets in shrouds, whatever. That's the kind of thing that, you know, you take with you. And that's what I'm going to miss. But of course, you know, I hope that with the great team I've worked with, that we've improved the reputation of the school, we've improved the environment of the school. But it really is about the people. It really is about the people. And that came home to me way back in the 70s. When I was up at Liverpool University. I finished there in 1979. And I think I'd been teaching nearly a year. I was invited to go back. And I went back to a dinner at my hall of residence. And I had a lovely time and, you know, there were tutors there that I'd known, a few of them. But this isn't the same. Why isn't it the same? And of course, it's not the same people. I go back to Haybridge and I went back to a do before Christmas for someone who was leaving. It's not the same. Although, again, there were a few people I knew. I go back to Nunnery. It's not the same. The buildings are pretty much the same, although, like here, buildings there have changed. It's the people. They're not the same people generally, and therefore that's what life is about, isn't it? That's the impact. So it's back to community. And can I share with you where this kind of comes from?
Please do.
My family were fourth, fifth generation miners, stroke, iron puddlers, workers in the Black Country in Brierley Hill. And so I take the story back to, it would have been, I think, yes, the Easter of 1947. And this young lad was obviously within this family. Everyone had been, his father, his grandfather, his great grandfather, been miners or iron workers, whatever. And he comes home on his last day of school because he was an Easter leaver at 14 years of age in 1947. He's clutching this letter from his headmaster. And this is a letter of recommendation to the Wolverhampton Express and Star, because his English teacher, his headmaster, has spotted this ability in this young lad. And he takes this letter home. When he gets home, his mother's there, but his dad isn't, because his dad's coming back from the mine. And he waits there for a couple of hours and his father appears and he gives him this letter. He reads it. He gives a bit of a humph and he throws it in the fire. That 14-year-old was my dad. And there's the influence. He was denied the opportunity. He had no redress for that. And he loved his dad, he loved his mum, but he had to know his place. I'm sorry. But he came from a community which in that case repressed him. And his dad literally said to him, "Don't you forget that Monday, you're off to the drop forge," which was the iron steel milling place. And he spent 5-6 years there, fighting his way out of there, joined the post office, and eventually became a postmaster. But his talents for that were lost. And he made up with by writing huge numbers of letters. I've never shown you my dad's book, have I?
No.
He never lived to see it, but when he died in 2006, my sister and myself put together this book of his letters. And it now becomes joyful, not upsetting. It's never upsetting, but that was... And so as a result of that, my dad and my mother wanted us to have the education he never had. And so instead of being fifth, sixth generation miners or knowing your place as my sister would have to do, I was the first to go off to university. I had all the joys of that.
He must have been very proud of you.
I hope so, yeah. And the book is called Crumpled Bits of Paper. And it's a line from a song, but it's because we knew he'd done all this, but he sent so many letters to the Express and Star. And some of them were very incorrect politically, so you'll probably love them. And they were all about these, you know, the issues. It's interesting. He would have had wonderful views about Brexit and all that. And so we, my sister and myself, we put it together in this book, which charts him and at long last got him in print.
Excellent.
And of course, there's other influences, just to calm myself down a little bit, were also people who believe in you. And that happened in school. And there were two people in particular, which is why I'm in about the influence. One of them was a bloke called George Yardley. And I mean, I thought for ages that he must have been the head of our primary school, but he wasn't, but he was the main senior teacher in the school. And he was a paratrooper who'd served in the Far East during the war. He was a bit of a character. You know, he had nicotine stained fingers and he smelt of cigarettes, never did it in front of us. I remember on occasions where he set up the TV and we had to watch horse racing in the afternoon. I mean, he would have been struck off now. But he was just such an inspiration. I've still got a scar on the finger where he chopped me across the finger with a metal ruler, which was the way, you know, and all I did was talk when I did my hand up. Now that seems, well, why do I admire that person in spite of that cruelty? I mean, that happened, didn't it, then in the 60s. But he was a fantastic encouragement. He was the person who kind of got us through A11 plus, got us to grammar school, again, the first to do that. And then my history teacher at school, Peter Skidmore, who I saw once I'd got work as well, and I reunited with him, was again a much gentler person, a very quiet person. But again, he gave me faith to say, you know, because I didn't think this was the working class. I can't, first of all, how can I do grammar school? And then I certainly can't do university. That's not for me. And there's another message, isn't it? Because I'm ranting on a bit here, but although my parents did have to give up a bit to kind of subsidise me, I got a full grant. I got, maybe we can't afford that, but how many good people are we losing by the fact they don't want to start their lives with £27,000 of debt? So, you know, these are key messages, I think, for people generally, not just... And I know that there are youngsters here who have not gone to university in recent years because their parents don't want to see them go through all that debt and previously maybe couldn't afford it all. I've calmed myself now.
It's a different world, isn't it?
It is a different world, but I think we've got to think about priorities, you know? Mm. I mean, if I had my way, I cannot see a reason. I'm not CND, particularly. I'm not kind of left-wing commie. But I can't see why do we need nuclear weapons? Why do we need armed forces? I mean, you know, if there was a nuclear war anyway, who wants to live in the world where we're living? Yeah, I just think that we invest in the wrong things. And they're saying the same things about hospitals and NHS and police and everything else. Misplaced priority.
Clive, have you got a message for the headmaster of Pershore High School in 100 years' time?
Gosh. Well, I think by then it'll be interesting to see whether schools are the same as they are now. Because to be honest, with all the new gadgets we've got, we still have desks and chairs, and in a different way, they, you know, we are still the Victorian school. We are still the school in many ways that schools were then. So I'll be fascinated by all the wizardry and the gadgetry that we won't even be able to predict. There's talk about teachers as robots, you know, and all that. And then, well, that's nonsense. I think in the end, my message would be simple. And it would be to remember that whatever gadget you're using, whatever form the school takes, whether people come in on Saturdays or learn remotely from home, remember that it will still be about people. And it's the famous quotation, if you've ever heard it, from Catherine the Great to Voltaire. It's the historian again in me, but basically, in the 18th century, of course, she was quite a naughty lady as well. If you read about Catherine the Great, there were some quite exciting things that went on in her personal life, but won't go there. She became Empress of Russia, and before she became Empress of Russia, she had spent a lot of time both meeting and writing to Voltaire, the famous French philosopher. And they exchanged all kinds of ideas and excitement about what she was going to do when she became Empress of Russia. And of course, as happens, real life took over when she became Empress of Russia. And Voltaire began to write to her to say, Your Majesty, many of the promises that you have made, many of the things you said that you were going to do, you've not done. And she wrote back to him and said, Sire, you work on paper. I work on human skin that is much more ticklish. And that's the message. It is that whatever resources are being used, whether we've got enough money or too much money, it comes down to giving our best for the youngsters, doing our best, and realising that those human relationships are what makes the difference. I mean, I won't name names, but my first head of history that I had was brilliant in terms of history. She knew more about history than I ever would. But frankly, she was not a very good teacher. And she didn't have the empathy. You know, you've got to like children. And there are too many teachers that don't like children. And so I hope that is a coherent message, whoever that person may be. My view of all of this is I've just been so lucky. You know, I'm nearly 60 years of age. I've been at this for 38 years. And quite honestly, I've enjoyed 990 days of the 1,000 that I've walked through every school door I've been. I've just been blessed. And then I am, you know, financially in the position to be able to retire, which I'm very fortunate with. And basically, I'll be honest with you, I think if it wasn't for the accountability and all the Ofsted rubbish, I might well be quite happy to go on another 5 years.
What are you going to do in your retirement then? Are you going to be sitting in a chair with your slippers on in front of the fire?
Oh, definitely, yes. Yes, I do. I need to buy a new pair of slippers, probably, and make the fire more welcoming. But no, I mean, as well as educational things I will be doing, we have a granddaughter, and she's only 3 at the moment, and there may well be more on the way. No pressure there, kids. We also have a Cocker Spaniel Grand Dog. So I think one day a week with either the two of them together or two separately. But then I will be working with other schools that I've been asked to support some head teachers. Okay, I'll go in, I'll get paid a little bit, and I'll come out without any accountability. But hopefully I can still make a difference. And above all, what I'm going to be in most of is this organisation called Schools of Tomorrow. And it's going around the country trying to convince schools, because it's a small organisation at the moment, that yes, we want high levels of achievement, but we need to make sure that staff and pupils have real well-being. We need to make sure we're working with our communities and our families. And above all, do we make a difference to the futures of the children? Because when we talk about outcomes, it's just what can be weighed or measured. What I mean about that is, are they kind? That faith input again, are they kind, are they considerate, are they going to be good team players? Above all, are they going to be really good citizens of the future? So, you know, that's what I came in to do, make a difference. But in addition, I also have a number of books that I am going to write. There are some more of my sad Wolverhampton Wanderers football books. I've got a mate called Steve Gordos, whose book I published for him. And he and I are beginning to work together on a Wolves book, which I won't bore you with the details. But my favourite one is going to be, and you may have to edit the name of this, but my book on education containing many of these thoughts is going to be Edubollocks. And forgive the language, but it is going to be a light-hearted look, but it will have many serious points in it, but it's how we've lost our way with education. Because education for the masses was introduced as a means of control back in the late 19th century and was, of course, became more general after the war, Second World War. So I've got lots of things I want to say, but I want to wait till I won't bring down the wrath of anyone on Pershore High School. It'll just be me. But so, however long I'm spared in my retirement, I don't think there'll be much slipper action.
Clive Corbett, I think you should have been our Prime Minister. Thank you very much for talking to us, and we wish you a long and happy retirement.
Thank you very much. Thank you.